So again, we're modifying the signature. This NAG call takes care of the calling convention, whether it's C-decimal or Win32. We're taking the communications. We're passing our input parameters. We're going to call the NAG function, this Black-Scholes price. We're looking for this sigma. So this is our x value that we're looking for the root of. And then we don't actually want to return prices, because this is going to actually compute the prices. And we want to find that root, which is the difference between prices and our target. So here you're packing up your variables, you're putting them in your user or your pointer, whatever you want to use. And then to call the function, just call it. So if you look at the documentation, what this, let me screw this up. So in the documentation, this x, this is your sigma value. That's what you want the root of. These are your two error tolerances. So how well do you want the root? You know, what sort of tolerance do you need? This is your callback function, so we're going to pass our BS function here. Notice the signatures are the same. There's integer nf max, so number of maximum iterations you want your function to do. Your nag com, and then your nag error. Is there a question? Yeah. Yep. So that's for the integer size, is whether the 32 or 64 bit.
Basically, just what you. So nag will.
So his question was, here this has to be a global function, it can't be a class member function. No, it can't, but if you want it to be a class member function, we've created these templates online, if you go to our blog and see. What you actually do is you actually pass the pointers to that function in this comp structure. So use that P, and this comp structure will actually evaluate that callback for you. So you pass the pointer to the function is going to be in here, and then once in this comp, it's evaluated. So I can show you maybe I can show you a template later.
Okay.
So the com.user is just doubles.
Just doubles.
The com.iUser is just integers, pointers to integers. Okay. And then the com.p is pointer to anything. Okay. Yeah.
Zero.
Yep, but so you're going to want to pass the address of that, right? Yeah, or something. Okay. So then for your function to call it, pass the address of sigma.
What's an fmax?
These are your error tolerances. So these are in the notes. It just says use these default values. This is your call function. So let's pass BS here. It says NF max, it says to use 1500. And then passing your com. And then it's red here because the com structure. So it turns out you don't want to pass the actual whole structure. You want to pass the reference to it, so a pointer to it. Hopefully it goes away. And be sure to include the header file too. Yes, the header files by chapter. So these are all the root finders in C05. Sorry?
What is the result?
The result is 15.
What is it going to be?
So again, this is the root finder. You're passing your x values, your error tolerances, callback function, number of iterations, communication structure, and then null. And to build it, the question is, how do you initialize if you want to use the fail parameter?
Yeah.
What you can do is you can first you. Yep. So first you declare it. So NAG error. Fail. Yeah, thank you. And then use capital set. Fail.
Somehow it's giving me an error.
Are you passing the address of fail in?
I think exactly the same thing. It's actually at the set field line.
You'll notice if you run it, you should get an answer like this. So remember, we're going backwards from the first step. We had a volatility of 0.09, getting the answer. Now we're going backwards. So the answer is 0.09. If you want that to be a little tighter, you can tighten these tolerances. So maybe you want the 10th. And then if you rerun it, hopefully it'll be more. Yeah, 0.09 and many decimals. Yep, so that's for passing your particular data into NAG functions. So you can't actually create other variables because our functions, their signature is specific. It's for this function, the callback is x and NAGcom. You can't add extra arguments. So you have to pass it via this NAGcom. Yep. And what you can do is you can actually just pass like a pointer to maybe your other parameters. So here we used a pointer to doubles, but you could have maybe a structure and just pass a pointer to that structure or a vector, pass a pointer to the vector. Okay. Other questions?
What's the solving mechanism behind this? Why is it based on derivatives?
This one's not based on derivatives. This one, let's go look at the documentation to actually how it solves it. So the description, arguments, any error parameters, let's see, where's... approximation. So it says, consult this for details on the method on how it works. And here's a description. It uses this algorithm. So, other questions? Yes?
I got the pin answer between here, but the answer is slightly different from yours. It's why the difference comes.
Yep. I increased my tolerances for my answer just to, to make it more.
Is some crypto case that's being handled
or it was a scaling
field, what should we do?
So the error should be in here, some sort of scaling factor. So
right.
Okay, while you do that, maybe we should go to the next problem. So we have about 50 minutes left. We can choose, we can either do Monte Carlo simulations, price a basket option, or calibrate the Heston model. So the Monte Carlo simulations are going to use a random number generator from NAG, in addition to some other multiplying matrices, or we can calibrate the Hessian model, certain parameters. It's up to you. Do you have any preference? Monte Carlo? Is that? Okay, let's do the Monte Carlo example then. Okay, so now I have some PowerPoint slides for this. So next up is, you know, simulation. So this is used in a variety of cases for pricing. If you're pricing any exotic option, you need to simulate a bunch of random number generators. So it's used for hedging. So you need a source of randomness. No. We're going to use the G05 chapter, the random number generators, where we have a variety of RNGs for different distributions. So I think we have about 4 or 5 pseudo and 4 or 5 quasi random number generators. And depending upon what sort of random number generator you use, you're going to get faster convergence for certain ones, pseudo versus quasi. So it's really good to have a high quality RNG.
For pseudo, what's the dimensionality that can be generated? What's the highest degree of freedom?
For NAG?
Yeah, the random number. How many independent ones?
You can generate as many as you need.
For pseudo, it has a.
So basically, we're going to generate a whole bunch of RNGs, and then we're going to price an option via that way. So, okay. So let's turn to our project. Let's go to the next one so we can X these out. How do I view the? Go to the properties window. No, properties. Let's go to the solution. So go to Monte Carlo simulation. And then you can right-click that and set that as your startup project. And then also right-click it, check the properties, and make sure this is set to V100 and not V120. Okay. Okay. Then in our project, we're going to be using random number generators, so we're going to include the G05 chapter. Okay. And then for random number generators, we're going to have two calls to two NAG functions. The first call is going to initialize all of the variables. Second call is going to actually generate the random numbers. So we need to initialize the random numbers is because you need some sort of state in order to generate the random numbers, right? You need some sort of starting values to generate random numbers and do that repeatedly. And so we're going to do that with one NAG call and pass that state variable to generate the actual RNGs. So to do that, we'll follow the question. It says, declare our variables and two seeds. A seed array and a state array. Okay. So we're going to want to declare our variables. Double S is 100. Double K. So this is just, I'm reading out the problem. Double T equals 1.5. R is 0.03. Q equals 0.015.
0.09. Are all both of those doubles?
Yep, those are all going to be doubles, and those are in the problem. Okay. Then we also need an N. So N is how many RNGs are going to generate. And here it gives us, we want a million. These are the same from the previous exercise, yes. So we should get the same answer as we go to many simulations. We're also going to need some place to store these numbers. So we'll create our array Z. And since we're creating the array, we probably should delete it as well. Okay. And so it gives you in the problem, it says create two arrays, a seed and a state of unsigned integers. So let's create these arrays. Says set the first six elements of seed to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So we can do that. This, I'm going to say seed sub I, so I plus one. So set the first six elements to I plus one. Okay. And it says call G05KFC. So we should find G05KFC. G05. Thank you. 05. And if you look through, it's not in. Oh, it's in there somewhere. Let's go to, it's easier to find it through the documentation. Go to G05, and it's the first one. So that's going to initialize our random number generator. Yep. So I just copy that over. Okay. We're going to call that, remember, this is going to initialize our seed and state arrays to actually generate the random numbers. It gives you the NAG base RNG. And it says use NAG underscore MRG 32KA. That's one specific random number generator. So 3A. There was, yep, back in the old Fortran days. For sub ID, what do we use? Zero? Okay, this is seed. What do you think L seed is?
Size of seed or size of integer?
Yep, it's the size of your seed. So L seed's the size of seed. Here's your state array. What do you think L state is? The size of your state. So it turns out this is a, you may ask yourself, why is it a pointer to an integer? You know, we had L seed was just 6. It was just an integer. Why is this a pointer to an integer? Where would you go to understand why this is a pointer to an integer? Our documentation. So it turns out if you look through the arguments, the L state is actually an input output. So you give it a number in, and then it's actually going to come up with a different number out. So on entry, it's the size of state. So initially, it's going to be 70. But on exit, it could be different. OK. So to do that, we'll have to just create our integer else state. So we'll pass the address of else state in. And then just null. So that'll initialize our random number generator. And then we call G05 SKC. Okay, and that's going to generate our mean 0, variance 1 RNGs. Okay. So I'll get the signature for G05 KSC. SKC, sorry. So this function generates a vector of pseudo random numbers, mean mu and variance sigma. Okay, and then you can look at the documentation for what these arguments actually are. But as you can imagine, this is the number of random numbers we want, your mean, your variance, just that state array that we just created. X are your actually RNGs, what you get out, and whether there's an error. So we want n random numbers. We want them mean 0 and variance 1. Let's pass the state array in. R where we want them, and then a neat NAG error. Does it know what? I'm sorry.
How does the rand_normal knows the size of the state?
How does it know the size? That's a good question. I think in the state array, one of those elements is a size. So in state is an array of integers, and one of those elements is actually the size of it. Question. So that is for, you can't. So the NAG library, there's 32 and 64-bit variants for integer. So when you store the, in memory, the data, it's just the size of those. So in 32-bit, it's going to be some length n, and 64 is going to be twice as long. And so you can store basically twice as many numbers in these 64-bit integer arrays. But the NAG library needs to know that because it needs to know how big is this, how big is the data in this certain block in order to compute values for it. So because we create these two different libraries for 32-bit integers and 64-bit integers, we have to create this special data type called integer to deal with that. Does that help? This, I think it might be okay to pass an int in here since it's just a number, but anytime you have an arrays, you need to use the integer. Question? Okay. Okay, so now the RNGs are in this Z. And now we can price our option via that way. Okay. So maybe let's check to make sure we got random numbers in there. How about that? So maybe let's do a little for loop. Let's check maybe 10, just to see to make sure we have the value is filled. So we'll see out them. Okay, just to verify. And that looks good. Looks like
the number's negative as expected.
Do you think that's okay?
If they're negative? Wait a minute, I have the same numbers as you do. Or is it because the same seeds are?
It's the same seed, yeah, you have the same numbers as me, the same seed. Have you seen, there's a book on Amazon, it's like 100,000 normal, standard normal deviates, and it's just page after page of random numbers. That, in the reviews on the book, they're like, oh, this is amazing. I read it once, and I couldn't put it down or something. So check that out, it's like 100,000 standard normal deviates. Okay, so then to price our option, it says to take the Monte Carlo average here. So we can just code up this formula. Okay, looks like we're gonna have a for loop for int I equals 0, I is less than n, plus plus. Sorry, what? Oh, thank you. Okay. We're gonna need some sort of sum.
I less than n less than equal plus 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 plus.
Thank you. I'll change that. Okay. We have our loop. And then we're going to add our values. So I'm just reading it off, S times exp. R minus Q minus sigma squared. Divided by T plus sigma.
R minus sigma.
I'm sorry, thank you, R minus Q. Okay, plus sigma times square root t times z sub I. This is just in the formula they're given. That quantity minus k. And then we want that, we're pricing a call option. So we want the maximum of that in zero. I'm sorry? The algorithm? Yeah, you can. I think we'll just use the math.h ones. So yeah, the question is, where does it know how to find max? And we can include math.h up here. And then it should, or is it cmath? Either way, we can just use the NAG one. So the NAG is capital MAX. That's defined in our header files. Okay. So from there, we have to discount. And then average them. And we can print the results to the screen. So my answer is different. So I must have made a small mistake. Oh, you don't divide by t here. You multiply by t. So hopefully that'll be it. Yep, that's the price of our option. All right, questions on that?
No questions at all.
Okay. So here we generated a million. Prices or a million RNGs for N. What if we want to do more? What if we want to do 100 or 1,000 or 100 million or a billion? Turns out you're going to get some run into memory issues eventually, right? You can't do 100 million RNGs in some sort of contiguous array. So, I mean, to get around that, what you could do is you could put a for loop around this if you wanted to. So root through million sets of RNGs at a time, price the option, average them. There are many ways to play around with NAG functions to do that. And that just requires one big for loop around this, and maybe declaring the sum instead of declaring it here, declaring it above. So, but there are ways to do that.